right? We're back, and we're going to listen to some public data now. Filip is going to talk to us about aspecting the backend. So, Filip.
The way you select a path in the data structure that you have is used in the child method. So let's see this. So with the child method, you say, okay, well, the app is the root of my data structure. When I say child, it appears to the structure, so I can shut the product. So I can enter a whole path here, which means I can say product/5/pairs. And I'll make multiple rules through the structure. The real fun starts when you start reading data, when you start using gets, HTTP gets. The thing is, in Firebase, you can read data in two ways. You can either select or read data only once, or you can attach an event listener to an object. And then once the object changes in the backend, Firebase will notify you and it will send you the value of the new value of the object that you modified. So you can get data synchronization out of the box for free, basically, as a service. There's one pitfall, and that is, let's say you have chat logs in your backend, and they're huge. You have 10 million logs, rows. Once a log changes, so if you're listening on the entire chat log, you'll get the entire chat log back from the server to the client, and that will cause performance issues. What you can use are the child added and child removed methods. Basically, once a log is added to the collection or removed from the collection, you will only get the object that's added or removed from the collection. Firebase supports transactions, and they act just like any other SQL transaction. They are basically a glorified set method. They are glorified because you can get custom JavaScript logic in the transaction function. And you can use, for example, other pieces of your database to update some other subnode in the JSON that you have in backend. Also, if the database changes while you are in a transaction, the transaction will fail and it will go back. Logging in is built into Firebase. It's very easy to get the user logged in or sign up. You basically construct this Firebase simple login. You pass in the app handler, and you can start. You can just say offline login the method and then the credentials. You don't have to use a password. Username and password authentication. You can use Firebase to basically log your users in with Google accounts, Facebook accounts, Twitter, and GitHub accounts. And now, since we have mentioned a login, you have to say something. Also, you have to handle security at the server side. You can't just do it on the client side. It's basically not safe, and it will get hacked. And the way you handle security in Firebase is Firebase lets you define these declarative rules for read permissions, write permissions, and for validating data. So you write these rules to check every time you make a request. Basically, every time you rewrite, Firebase will basically go through these rules and check whether they satisfy your constraints or not, and it will from your vulnerability paths. And then finally, Firebase also lets you go offline. So when your client goes offline, your client will stay consistent with itself. What that means is Firebase, when you modify data, Firebase stores changes locally. And then when you go, if you're offline, when you come online, Firebase will get in sync with the server and put the changes up. However, in case of conflicts, Firebase will not handle conflicts for you. Whoever basically writes last, Firebase is going to say, okay, well, I'm going to take that value because last one they come up. So if you have two clients who are offline, when they come online, you don't have a conflict and the last writes through. So Firebase is flash, cool, flashy, cool, fast, and everything, but it's not free and it's closed source. If you can modify it, and if you go to production, you will eventually have to pay something for it. What you can use as an alternative is a system called Deploy. Deploy is open source, it was built using Node.js and MongoDB, and you can extend it. Basically, if you're missing that functionality, you can write them for write the modules in this way. You can also make it available, publish it to GitHub, there's some tools for it. The thing is, it's self-hosted. You have to find some hosting place, but installation is very straightforward. So the way you install deploy is basically clone the Git repo. You say, okay, install anything in Git, and you're all set. Once you have deploy installed, you create an app with PPD create best app ever. I mean, this is the name of the app. And deploy will create a folder for you. You go to that folder, you say DPD, and your server is running. So you basically have Node.js and MongoDB server for you. That's the code. And you can use deploy the same way you use Firebase, basically. I'll just mention a couple of key differences in case you're interested in deploy. Validation and security get handled differently. Basically, deploy lets you inject custom JavaScript code, which gets executed before each get and post to your request. So basically, with this custom JavaScript code, you have to handle validation of the data you got and security whether users can read data or modify data. And another thing is, Firebase will update every time something changes in the backend. But with deploy, you have to explicitly say, okay, well, I have gone through this modification of fire an event to the plan and then notify the plan something has changed. So you have to do this explicitly with deploy. Deploy, finally, supports MongoDB like queries. So if you know MongoDB, that's the MongoDB query language, you'll get the full power of it. So basically, with Firebase, you have a very limited query language. You can just filter and I think you'll limit the amount of results. You can trim down the results. But here, you have everything you can do with MongoDB, you can do here. And there's also a basic type system in place, which means you don't have to check explicitly if you're if the value you've got from the client is, if you can say, okay, well, I want the price to be anywhere, and the deployer will make a check for you, and then for the session, if it's not. So if you're interested in NoBackend, you just go and Google NoBackend, and you'll get a list of services which you can use, which are both open source, for example, Ruby is open source, but I think Pinnacle parts are commercial. And just have fun with it, play with it, and tell us what you think about it. Thanks.
Hi, great talk. Thank you very much. My question is basically that the Firebase comes with libraries for various languages, so it's a library, etc. So I'm just wondering whether the same exists for deploy.
Not that I'm aware of. So I don't think so. I think that the deploy was mainly meant to be used with JavaScript. So I haven't really used deploy all that much. I've started with Firebase something. That's a very good question, and unfortunately, I can't give you the answer.
Yeah, hello. In Firebase, set aside the validation, is it possible to add any more business logic?
Unfortunately not. The idea is basically if you want to write business logic, you should do it at the front end. So that's the whole query that is called NoBackend. You basically get a validation rule because you have to have some validation for the server. But all the business logic you do, you should do that. So again, write it full for the result.
Okay. Any more questions? No? Okay, thank you. So this was the last
session. And now there's something else. Let's sit down. So, if you noticed, we have a game sponsored by Google, which you can win an X file. Find the stickers on the pillars and answer it. That's one thing. And the other thing is, well, who wants? You can go drink now. We're going to have a wake up here at this bar. And we have a time.